Hello, my name is Carolina Marín Pedreño. I am a solicitor practicing in England and Wales, partnered at Dawson Conway Solicitors, and also a Spanish qualified avocada. I have been asked by the Hague Conference to address issues addressed by the Hague Convention 1996, like relocation, custody, and access. In this 25th anniversary celebration of the Hague Convention 1996. Please allow me to say thank you to the Hague Conference, to the Permanent Bureau, and in particular to their first secretary, Jerry Escolar, for inviting me to be part of this celebration. It's a real honor to be here with you today. When preparing my talk about relocation, custody, and access, I thought it would be interesting to discuss with you where is the Hague Convention 1996 in England and Wales. What I mean is, like, what is the treatment of the Hague Convention 1996 these days? When the 1996 came to life, it was, as we know, following the 18th session of the Hague Conference in 1996. At that time, the United Kingdom was a member, state member of the European Union. The European Union was at the time working in a similar instrument to the Hague 1996, dealing with jurisdiction, recognition and enforcement, and international cooperation on matrimonial matters that came to effect in 2001, Brussels II. In 2003, 2 years later, that was extended to also parental responsibility matters. So the European regulation dealt with children protection issues in Brussels IIb's. I have to say that the fact that the European regulation was have effect and it was applicable between all the European member states did maybe stop the Hague Convention from acquiring more signatory countries following the coming to life. In fact, United Kingdom signed in 1996 in 2012. And once we become a signatory country, as a practitioner, I have to say that the convention was not applied so frequently. It was only in very odd cases where we need to apply the 1996. When we are dealing with cases that countries were, that they were not members of the European Union, or they were signatory countries of the, but they were signatory countries of the 1996. So I remember my first case was an application for recognition of an English order in Russia. It was a very well-known case. It was in the media because it was the first case where Russia applied the 1996 convention with the UK. Two children or three siblings, they were retained in Russia by their father and the mother at the time. There were welfare proceedings going on in England and Wales where the children were habitually resident. So we applied to the English court, to the High Court, for a declaration that the children were habitually resident in England and Wales and that they should be returned immediately to England and Wales. That order was enforced, it was recognized and enforced by the Russian courts. And not without difficulties, but physically the children returned with the mother finally to England and Wales following the successful application before the Russian courts. So very useful instrument at the time because the Russia has not signed the 1980 at that time. So it was very helpful to have the 1996 to seek the recognition and enforcement of English orders in that situation. Then we use it again. It was in a wrongful removal from Morocco to UK, again, non-EU country. The children were ordered to return to Morocco, but the English court put in place some protective measures under Article 11 of the Hague Convention 1996 for their return to be safe. Those protective measures were recognized and enforced by the Moroccan courts even before the children were physically back in Morocco. So another example of how useful it was the Hague Convention 1996 for international families and how well it was applied by the English courts and other signatory countries of the Hague 1996. However, as I said, it was like that distant cousin that you only see in the odd wedding. It was only used very rarely whenever we have a case with a non-EU member state, but a signatory country of the Hague, 1996. But everything changed following the exit from the European Union by the UK, following Brexit. I think the best present for the Hague 1996 in its 25th anniversary has been Brexit. So if there is any positive things, I have to say is that now our main instrument of that we apply for international children cases is the Hague 1996. And it's a very valuable and very helpful instrument. And that is what I'm going to discuss now. I thought it would be interesting just to highlight those articles of the Hague Convention that become very instrumental and very significant for protection of children in international relocation cases or international cases of access or custody. When we are talking about relocation, we know that we are dealing with the removal of a child from one jurisdiction where he or she is a habitual resident to another country with the permission of the parent who have parental responsibility or with a court order. I think at that time, when you are dealing with those cases, the parent who is going to be left behind because when the permission is going to be granted, what is more worried about is who is going to be dealing with the future of my child if we have a disagreement again. So certainty is something that the Hague Convention 1996 provides in its Article 5. Article 5 makes it very clear that the court that will have jurisdiction is the court where the child is a habitual resident. This is not linked to a certain period of time, and this is something that is really helpful and provides a lot of security. So in other instrumental, in other regulations, European regulations or in the States, the habitual resident is linked to the passage of time, not by the Hague Convention 1996. And I think that is very wise. When a client asks you to explain to them what is habitual residence for a child in a child context, is quite, I normally use the example of when a child changes schools, even in the same city. So some children move to a different school and within a couple of days or a couple of weeks, they are fully integrated in the new school. And sometimes that is because of the circumstances around that child, their family and friends and language or subjects that he's going to be studying in the new school. In other cases, you remove a child to another school, you change them to another school, and it takes months for that child to integrate and to settle in the new school. So that is why I think it's very helpful that the Hague Convention 1996 has not defined habitual resident and has not linked habitual resident to a passage of time. Child can become habitual resident, as I say, in days or in months. Every case is different. We know that in the European context, we follow the jurisprudence on the European Court of Justice, and we determine jurisdictions to the definition of something that helps us to understand and to assess habitual resident is when there is a level of integration in the new country. So it's a factual examination of every single circumstances of a child. As I said, and I repeat again, I think I really applaud that the Article 5 is so clear on jurisdiction, and this provides a lot of security for international families when there is an international relocation. Another issue that I wanted to address dealing with jurisdiction is the fact that the Hague Convention limits the prorogation of jurisdiction to the fact that it has to be by agreement and when it's linked to a divorce proceedings. I think this is also very helpful because we know from other instruments that the prorogation of jurisdiction, so the courts where the child was habitually resident before a lawful removal, retained jurisdiction is not providing any legal certainty. I don't think we know that in practice, and the reality is that those courts are not the best courts to be dealing with the child welfare issues because the child is not living in that jurisdiction. Something else in the jurisdiction issue is that, as I say, there's no link to timing, so we don't have the perpetuity fori that we have, for example, in the European instruments, that after the lawful relocation of a child to another country, the country where the child was habitually resident retained jurisdiction for 3 months to deal with access rights. Again, I don't think that provides legal certainty to international families, and it's something that the Hague 1996 doesn't provide, which is, I think, very wise. And when we are dealing with international contact cases, I would like to highlight the value of having the system of recognition and enforcement. It's not an automatic recognition. You need to seek first a declaration of enforceability and then to seek the enforceability. Article 23 of the Hague Convention 1996 is very helpful because give us the grounds for non-recognition. So this is really, in practice, it becomes very helpful because it's not such a wide scope when determining non-recognition of orders made by another signatory country state. And another thing that I wanted to highlight when we are dealing with international access orders, an order that you want to be recognized and enforced in another signatory country of the 1996, is the Article 24 of the Hague Convention 1996. I think this is extremely helpful because even before the court where the children are arbitral resident make an order that will need to be recognized or enforced by another signatory country of the Hague 1996, they can request to that country to confirm that the order will be recognized and enforced. I think, again, this is another article that provides a lot of certainty and reassurance to parents which are in international custody or access cases. And more important, provide protection to children, because that child is going to travel to another country, and before the travel, the parents will know that the decision taken by the country where he is habitually resident will be recognized and enforced in the country where he is traveling to. So this is what I wanted to highlight for relocation cases and access and contact cases. Those articles that are so helpful and provide so much certainty and legal security to international families. So before I conclude, because I am getting close to my 15 minutes, I just wanted again to congratulate the Hague Conference in this anniversary. We have now, I believe, 53 signatory countries to the Hague Convention. Let's hope that before our 50th anniversary, we will have another 52. I don't understand why those countries who have signed the 1980 Convention on the Civil Aspect of Child Abduction has still not signed the 1996. The two instruments complement each other, and the two of them provide a lot of certainty and protection to children worldwide. So here, from my humble voice, in this anniversary, I invite countries to consider signing to the 1996 Convention to protect children internationally within their countries. Thank you so much for your attention. And again, congratulations to the Hague Conference on this anniversary.